In this session, let's primarily look at the measurement of the interest rate risk. How do I measure the interest rate risk? There are a few tools in level 1 for us to typically focus on the measurement of the interest rate risk aspect. One, we'll be talking about tools like duration and convexity. These are the two words. Duration we just got introduced in our earlier chapter also, whereas convexity is a small improvisation on the top of the duration which we would be looking at. Now, whenever we are talking about finding out the price of the bond is what we are calling our finding, not the market price, the intrinsic value. What should be the price of the bond? That should be the price. If it is less than the price, we say it is undervalued. More than the price, we call it as overvalued. The same way we have used in case of equity. So this intrinsic value is always computed as present value of the future cash flows. Now here, for a bond, we are talking of two different mechanisms of computing the price. One is using this same intrinsic value kind of a mechanism, where I will find out the present value of all the future cash flows and discount them. And finally, say this should be the price associated with the bond. That kind of a valuation is called as a full valuation approach, where you are doing the total calculation and valuation of the bond in full. You are taking all the future cash flows and then finding out the present value of all the future cash flows based on a particular rate of return, and that is what you are calling as the value of the bond. Whereas the other approach which we are typically looking at is a duration based approach. If you remember the way we have defined the duration, percentage change in the price of the bond divided by percentage change in the yield or the interest rate, right? So we do, using the duration based approach, I can very well estimate what would be the percentage change in the price of the bond. Will it go up by 2%, go down by 5%? I can very well estimate what should be the percentage change in the price of the bond, and based on that I can very well find out the find out the modified price. That is a duration and convexity based approach. Convexity will define it, but when I am using a duration or a convexity or a both kind of an approach, that should be the model for me. So I am not doing all future cash flows and finding the present values, nothing. Okay, interest rates have changed by 1%. Find out what, based on the duration, you say that the price will change by this much of percentage. So it's a straightforward calculation kind of thing. It's more of a easier to compute kind of stuff. But it's very more simpler. But the only thing is, it works only if there is no yield curve risk. If there is yield curve risk associated, then the full valuation approach itself is a much better thing, because for different maturities, you cannot directly use a simple multiplication factor, because the different interest, different terms change at different interest rate. So it's not advisable to go with one single factor for that, right? Or even if there are complex instruments like callable bonds, only plain vanilla bonds You will typically go with a duration kind of an approach. Any kind of complex features that are associated with the bond, it's always better to go with a full revaluation. Though it takes a lot of time, though it requires a lot of knowledge, but that is much more better, because it takes into account all the possible future cash flows, and we can do all kinds of complex things. Be given as input into that kind of a model, and we can very well compute it. So especially where complexity is there in the product and all, we can very well resort to a duration or convexity kind of a model. So that's where we are saying, if at all the bond is having some option kind of features in it, callable bond, puttable bond, it's always the duration and convexity are never a good tools directly to find out the value of that bond. Because if we remember, in case of callable bond, the bond shape is changing, price yield curve. When we have earlier plotted the yield here and price here, for a normal bond, we said that the shape is more like this. Whereas for an option bond which is having a call option, we said that the graph will go like this. The gap which is equivalent to the premium associated with the call option. Right? Now what is happening is the shape of the, this is up to here, there is some shape for this bond, and from here there is some other shape, which means there are two different equations that are playing with respect to those kind of bond. Whereas if it is an option free plain bond, it's only one single curve that is coming down. No diversions or no change in the shape, right? So that is where, when the bond is more and more straightforwardly priced like this, using a duration or a convexity based approach should still be a better estimator. But when the bond goes with a different shape, especially when there are options, you will find that the shape of the bond keeps changing drastically, whether it is a callable bond or a puttable bond. So what we are simply saying is, duration and convexity based simplified calculation mechanisms are not that applicable or not that effective if the bond is having embedded features like options. Then in that case, the full valuation approach itself is a much better tool for the finding out of the price of the option. Now here, one important context for us is, see, when I look at the price yield curve relationship, this is the relationship we talked about. When we talk about the word duration, it is nothing but, it's a tangent to this curve. Mathematically, when I draw a tangent to this curve at some point, at this point, if I am drawing a tangent, this particular line is called as a duration. Right? So percentage, I mean, the definition also is percentage change in price by percentage change in interest rates. Mathematically, this is nothing but a derivative. The differentiation. Differentiation between the two. So when I am doing a differentiation of a curve, I get a straight line. So duration actually comes out like a straight line. Now what is happening is, okay, if I am using this duration, so this is the line that is corresponding to duration, this is the curve that is corresponding to the price, right? Price on the y-axis and yield on the x-axis. If I take the interest rate on the x-axis and price on the y-axis, I'm getting a curve. If I'm taking the duration on the y-axis and plotting it,